Hello, this is Kevin Bacon, and as I promised, this is going to be my video on building a solar panel for collecting heat off the side of my house. And that's what we're going to work on today. Okay, the first thing you're going to need for this project is a big window. And in this case, I salvaged this big chunk of glass. It's a double pane from a construction site. They were going to throw it away, so they gave it to me, and they even helped me load it in the back of my pickup truck. So, once again, keep it cheap, free is free. And it's about 5 feet square. It's not exactly square, so 5 times 5 is 25. That'll be 25 square feet. If you watched my previous video, 25 square feet times 10 square feet of floor space. This solar heater should heat 250 square feet of floor space when it's being hit by the sun. Now, maybe not totally hot, and maybe not a total thing, but multiply your solar collector space by 10, and that gives you a basic general idea how much solar collector space you need to heat a particular room. So we're going to get 200 square feet of solar floor space heated with this 25 square foot chunk of glass, and that's where we're going to start. Okay, this is where I'm going to put it, right here on the side of my house between these two windows. I have a window on the left and I have a window on the right. The problem is there's not enough room between the two windows for the piece of glass. So I'm going to have to remove these two fiberglass shutters in order to get space to put it there. Not a big deal, they're just fake anyway, and that's where we're going to put it. And I'm going to ultimately heat this room over here on the right with it. That's where my office is. So, here we go. Okay, that's Daisy. She's one of my noisemakers. She likes to play ball. And there's Casey up there on the hill. Okay, there we go. Now I'm going to turn around here, and we've got the shutters down off the wall. I want to emphasize that you better check your codes and zones and landlords and all that kind of stuff before you go punching holes in your house, because you might get yourself in trouble. Also, practice ladder safety. Now, here are the shutters I took off. You might wonder, what in the world are you going to do with those things? I mean, they're just big chunks of fiberglass painted a funny color. And I hope to turn these into bat shelters, since they do have slots that go through to the other side. That'll let air in and maybe give a place for the bats to hang on. So, the next step to building my panel on the side of the wall is to find the center so that we can work out from the center. And then we have to determine where we're going to put our holes through the walls. Now, since these windows are pretty high up here, I'm going to try to match the bottom of the panel with the windows so that it gives it a nice appearance. I think that if it was staggered or something, it might look kind of crude. So there's a line at the bottom of the window where the clapboard goes right straight across, and I'm going to use that as a basis for the bottom of the solar collector, and we're going to go up from there. All right, on to the next step. Okay, my piece of glass is 58 1/4 by 65 1/4. So what I'm going to do is start out with 2 2x4s, 58 1/4. Since I want the narrow side at the bottom to match the basic pattern of my windows on my house, there's the center line, and I measured over 26 1/8 on both sides. So now I'm going to cut 2 2x4s, and all of my wood that I'm using on here is salvaged lumber, so I'm going to use 2 2x4s, 58 1/4 in length. All right, be back. There we go, we got the first board up now, and I'm going to cut the two uprights. We'll put the uprights on there, and then we'll put the top one after we get them on. When assembling the uprights, it's going to be real handy to have a good carpenter square. If you don't have a good carpenter square, Very simple way to make sure that this frame is going to be square is measure from the corner to the corner, and then again from the corner to the corner, and those two distances should be the same. If they're the same, it's square. Whichever side is longer, squish it together until you get them even, and it'll be square. I guarantee you that that window pane that I'm about to put on here is square, so we want to make sure that this frame is extremely square. Now that I got the first leg up and square, I'm going to install the second leg. But this bottom board's got just a little bit of warpage to it, so rather than squaring that up with the bottom board and running it all the way to the top, nailing it down, only to find out that the top doesn't match when I'm done, I'm just going to tack the bottom of it, and then I'll put the top piece on. When I put the top piece on, then I will be able to pull the two corners together and secure it, and it should be good and square. Now we got a frame. All we have to do is put something in it to be our collector. And I'll show you what we're going to do with that in just a second. Before we put the liner in this thing, I think the best thing to do is going to be to put our inlet and outlet holes on this system. And since I'm going to heat the room to the right here, those holes will probably be over here on the right side of the frame, one at the bottom and one at the top. Now I've already checked inside to make sure there were no electrical wires or anything like that in the way. It's very, very important that you don't start drilling through a wall and run smack dab into dangerous stuff. And the other side of it is, I don't believe there's any backer board behind this siding at all. So I'm going to get a hole saw and punch a hole through the outside and then continue on through into the sheetrock. The reason I'm going to do that is going to be a whole lot easier for me to find the frame out here where I can see it than it will be for clumsy me to go inside. And even with all my measurements, if I drill, I'm definitely probably going to be in the wrong place. So easiest for me, make my holes through from the outside to the inside. And that way I know for sure I don't hit one of these 2x4 studs. I don't hit, I don't know if you can see that nail right there or not. But there's a nail right there, and that nail is a stud behind this siding. We don't want to hit that either. So once again, and I do want to emphasize once again, if you're going to do this project, make sure your local codes and zones and all that kind of... Lesson learned, YouTubers. Charge the battery on your camera regularly. It will quit at the worst time. Anyway, here's the start of the hole from the outside. Now, the best thing to do is not to drill this hole all the way through, but drill halfway through like I did here. And then I'm going to take a punch and punch right through that center hole to the other side and out the wall. And that'll give me a center on the other side to work with, instead of trying to figure out how to get this to go through fiberglass and all kinds of other stuff in there for insulation. So that's what I'm going to do next. Now that I got two pretty holes out here, I'm going to go inside, make the complementary holes on the other side, and install some duct tubing to fill in the holes. Back inside the house, you'll see I got two very nice little pilot holes that I can follow with my hole saw to make the cuts in here so they should line up perfectly with the ones on the outside. And that way I don't have to try to cut through that insulation with the hole saw, which snags it all up and just makes a mess. So I'll just cut the hole nicely here, and then we'll push the insulation out of the way and we'll have our holes. Now we have two 4-inch holes. I drilled 4-inch holes because I happen to have some 4-inch duct tape or duct work. And also, a 4-inch hole, I believe, will work with some dryer vents, but you may have to check on that. So you want, if you're going to use a dryer vent to go out one of these holes, you want to make sure that the hole saw that you use matches the dryer vent. I did learn another thing while I was doing this, and that is my outlets are spaced just right around this little room that the cord to my electric drill wouldn't reach them, so I had to get an extension cord.
outside, I was using a 100-foot air hose and an air drill, so it didn't make any difference. But anyway, there we have two holes. Now I'm going to get some ductwork and shove through the holes. I took a piece of 4-inch galvanized duct and I cut it in half. And as you can see, on the edges of this thing are some really serious burrs. So I want to caution you when you're working with this stuff, if you haven't got a lot of experience, you better wear some good heavy gloves or you're going to end up bleeding a bunch, because it is seriously sharp. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to back in about an inch and I'm going to draw a line around here, maybe not quite, and I'm going to fold this on one end. I'm going to fold it in so that it makes a smooth edge on the outside, and on the other end I'm going to back out about an inch and I'm going to fold it out at a 90 degree angle so that when I push it through from the outside, it'll have kind of a flange on it to stop it from coming clear through the wall. That's what I'm going to do next. There we have our two ducts. You notice I folded the top edges down, so they'll be somewhat smooth. Once I get them installed, I'll wrap duct tape around them to give them a little smooth. And then on the outside, I built that flange so that we can push it up tight and it won't come on through. And there's my gloves in the back, proof positive. Better wear gloves when you're working with this stuff. Since this is such a precise fit going through there, what I'm going to do is take a pair of needle nose pliers and I'm going to put it in here and alternately twist all the way around here until I kind of pucker this in a little bit so that it'll go through the hole, and once I get it through the hole and back on the other side, I'll straighten it back out again. But otherwise, it's really, really a tight fit. There, that should easily provide me enough clearance to get through the two holes and out the inside. Without doing any damage to the pipe, I can straighten it out on the inside and it'll look just fine. As soon as you get these ducts driven in where they belong, you want to make sure you put a good coat of sealant around them. In fact, I put some sealant on them about 1/4 inch before they got all the way in, so that when I drove them in, they were nice and sealed on the back. I chose to use a clear general all-purpose sealer in this particular case, but you could probably use an automotive grade silicone or a good outdoor caulk. You want to use something that's going to be able to withstand some heat, and it needs to be flexible because it's going to warm up and cool down, and so it's got to have some room to expand and contract without cracking. I wouldn't use glass putty because window glass putty gets hard and crumbles after a while. In my case, I got a really, really tight physical fit, so we shouldn't have a problem, but just as a good insurance, I always put some kind of a sealer on it. Now I'm going to install some pink board. This is 1/4 inch pink board. You can use pink board, blue board, whatever you want, or nothing, because the siding will work as insulation, but I thought that the siding would have some sort of a heat resistance factor warming up in the morning, so since I've got this pink board laying around from previous projects, I'm just going to stick some in there. Very important, put the shiny side out, because when you paint this, especially if you use an aerosol can, the aerosol paint will eat this styrofoam stuff. So if it's vapor barrier side out, then you're spraying on a different kind of plastic. And we're not going to spray it real thick anyway, we're just going to give it a misting. But that's going on next.
She can do enough to get things done.
Okay, I got the pink board up here now. Next thing I'm going to do is put my metal substrate on there. And I'll show you what we got in just a few minutes. All right, this is what I'm going to use for my collector. This is what they call metal lath. And it's used to put on the outside of a house or the inside of a house to put either stucco or plaster on. And it's kind of an expanded steel. We'll see how close I can get to it. There you go. Expanded steel. So the sun should be able to, it should be able to collect in almost any direction because it's got a huge surface area. And what I did is I cut one of those panels in half and I doubled up on it. It doesn't quite reach clear across, but most of the way across. And then when I paint that black, there's going to be a lot of surface area for the air to go through and also for the sun to hit. So that should make it pretty efficient
and still keep it cheap. Now I have the lath installed on the wall. I doubled up on most of it. And somebody's going to go, "Oh, Kevin, you didn't make it clear to the top." But there's an overhang right above there, and actually it doesn't matter what time of year, the sun never ever hits that top several inches. On the other hand, my overhang is just perfect, so in the summer months, that collector is constantly in the shade, except the very early morning when the sun first comes up, and the rest of the time it's in the shade. So it'll work out just fine. On the next step, we're going to paint it. Okay, I got some paint on it. It's looking pretty good. I'm using a high temperature engine paint in a flat black. Actually, it says low gloss because flat wasn't available, but you want to use a flat paint. You don't want to put too much on because paint is basically plastic and you want the metal to be your heat exchanger, not the paint. So the thinner the paint, the better if you can get good coverage. That's going to be a problem with this paint board. I'm going to have to keep working on it till it's not too blotchy. I'm not going to worry about it if it's a little bit blotchy. It won't look too bad. Anyway, that gives you an idea. I can't paint anymore tonight because it's getting windy on me. Here it is, almost the last day of December down here by Kansas City, and almost 60 degrees. It's unbelievable. Anyway, I'll get back at it tomorrow and we'll see if we can get this thing finished up and fired up. I just wanted to show you here that I've only got a partial part of this painted yesterday before the wind got to me. And I'm out here in the sunshine right now. I put my hand on the side that's not painted, and it's about normal, about the same temperature as the rest of the side of the house. I put my hand over on the black side, and it is quite a bit warmer than the other side. So there's quite a difference between just painted, no glass over or anything, and the pink and unpainted lath. So I can tell a difference already, even uncovered. So the wind is blowing across and everything else, and it's warmer already, just having painted it black. So the black paint is doing a good job collecting, even though it's still not covered up with glass. Ah, good picture of Scamper there in the window, looking at me. Three cans of spray paint covered it. And of course I'm not surprised it took that much because it's a pretty uneven surface. There's a lot of surface area. When I was just finishing up on the ladder there with the last can, I can tell you it was getting pretty uncomfortable to be in front of that thing. It's pretty hot. The temperature out here is 60 degrees, and I'd venture a guess that even with that open in the wind, I'm gaining at least 20 degrees because I'm not comfortable in the heat. Of course, yesterday when I was working on about 60 degrees, I was wearing short pants too, so that might have something to do with it. But as you can see, we got it covered up, and the trick is I come out here every now and then and I walk away from it and I get a look at it and I look for blotchy spots. Right now it doesn't look too bad. I'm not gonna waste any more paint on it. I think there's plenty enough there to do the job. Now we'll let it cure and set that big hunk of glass up. Now I'll show you here. I put a 2x4 cleat down here on the bottom to rest the bottom half of that glass on because it's real heavy. Now, it's going to take two or three of us to manhandle it to put it up there. And when I fit it up, it's going to be even with the edges out here on the side. So then I'm going to use some clips to mount it to the side. I may put cleats on the side just like this to hold it on. I haven't quite decided yet. If I can make some hardware that looks pretty nice, I'd rather just use little angle iron brackets if I can get away with it. We'll see how that comes out as we go along. I also wanted to mention while I was here, you want to make sure if you're building one of these projects that your glass is not UV tinted, because if it is, if it has a UV resistance, you're not going to get any solar heat capability through it very much. So I would check that out first, and what I basically do is I set the glass out in the sun, let the sun shine through it, reach underneath and feel the grass underneath the grass should be warmer underneath the glass than it is next to the glass where it's not being have any sunshine on. You can tell if you get any solar radiation of any value through it. I have an example. I have a window down here that came out of a screen door, and it's gray tint, and it may or may not be of any value for a solar collector. Back to my hunk of glass. All right, I designed the frame to be the same size as this frame. So what I'm gonna do, the glass doesn't start till about where my thumbnail is. So I'm gonna drill some holes through this thing right about here. Then I'm gonna take these nifty little deck screws and I'm gonna screw that right up there to the frame. That way I can seal all the way around the outside edge very easily, and I can also seal on the backside. And we'll get a good tight weatherproof seal, and I won't have to worry about water coming in. And the nice thing about using this piece of double pane is I don't have to worry about losing a bunch of heat from the house coming out through this glass, because it's basically an insulated glass to begin with. I got some help yesterday from my son-in-law and my son, and we stuck this piece of glass up here. Now, what I need to do is finish sealing the outside edges and all the gaps around there, and finish putting up the mounting screws that are going to hold it up. You see that I haven't got them all in there yet. But that's the basic configuration now. And clean off the mud off the outside, and we should be ready for a test. There she is, up, pretty much cleaned up, sealed all the way around. And I'm going to have to do some more cleaning on it before I'm done. And I even see some handprints on the inside, but not much I can do about that right now. Anyway, the sun is now starting to get behind my walnut trees here, which is gonna shade it just a little bit, but it's still pumping out pretty good heat. So let's go inside. I'll throw a thermometer in front of that thing, and just gravity. I haven't got a fan on it yet, and we'll see what kind of heat we can get even with a little shade on it. It's 35 degrees outside. It's 60 degrees here in my office. I haven't modified the ends of these pipes or anything yet. And we'll just hold this up here and see what happens. I put a candy thermometer in it, and the temperature went well over 100 degrees quite quickly. Actually, it's warmer than I want to hold my hand there. So I put a little fan down here, just sitting on a table blowing air in. And this very, very comfortable air coming in. Still 110 degrees, almost 120 degrees, with the sun being blocked by some of my walnut trees and a little cloud cover coming in. I'd say that's pretty good for free heat. So I'm going to edit this thing and get it out there on the air so y'all can view it. Shoot me some comments, and I'll be looking forward to hearing from you. Thank you, Kevin Bacon,